This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
أخبار الرابعة من الصومال حيث قتل نحو 17 صوماليا في الاشتباكات المسلحة.
Nearly 17 Somalis were killed in the latest clashes that erupted between the Somali government-backed forces and Islamic opposition groups in southwestern Somalia. The head of the so-called Al-Shabaab al-Mujahideen said that the Islamic fighters have seized control of the town of Yait. This report, however, was denied by the Somali government sources. Meanwhile, the African Union envoy called for bolstering the AU mandate in Somalia. This news comes after 12 Burundian troops were killed last Thursday in an attack on AU forces.
وقتل فيه 12 جنديا بورونديا.
الاستعدادات جارية في العاصمة الصومالية مقديشو لاحتمال اندلاع هجمات شاملة.
Preparations are underway in the Somali capital of Mogadishu and are aimed at countering any possible attacks by Islamic rebels. The AU and Somali government forces are being mobilized to counter any possible attack on the Somali capital by the rebels. Fierce confrontations erupted today in the town of Yait in southwestern Somalia near the Ethiopian border. The rebels announced they have seized control of Yait, a report that was quickly dismissed by the Somali government. The government said its forces were able to counter the rebels' attack on Yait. Meanwhile, sporadic clashes have continued to break out in western Somalia, killing scores of people and injuring many others. The Islamic rebels have started to dig tunnels around their strongholds in Mogadishu. They are gearing up for possible attacks from the AU and government forces. The AU envoy in Bujumbura called for bolstering the presence of his forces in Somalia. He said that the AU forces need more equipment, better armor, and a stronger mandate, which gives the troops the right to pursue the attackers if necessary. This news comes after the twin attacks on the AU headquarters in the capital last week, in which 12 Burundian troops were killed. Meanwhile, the head of the Islamic party, Sheikh Hassam Dahere Weiss, called for the killing of AU troops because he says they support the Somali government, which is led by Sheikh Sharif Ahmad, the head of Islamic courts. Weiss also called for the withdrawal of AU forces from Somalia, saying that his country will not see peace so long as these forces are continuing to be deployed there. He added that the Somali government and the AU forces are being backed by the West. It seems that the situation on the ground is escalating, which is causing concern among the residents of Mogadishu. Meanwhile, several UN relief agencies have warned of an increase in the number of Somali war casualties. Safa al-Dahi al-Arabiya.
Joining us from Mogadishu is our Al-Arabiya correspondent, Abdul Rahman Bukhari. Abdul Rahman, let's talk about the issue of tunnels. The rebels are digging tunnels in areas that have fallen under their control. Does this indicate that the Somali capital is bracing for another wave of fierce confrontations? These seem to be large-scale preparations.
The digging of tunnels seems to be the new strategy of Islamic opposition groups. They started to adopt it just a few days ago. Leaders of the Islamic opposition said that the purpose of these tunnels is to impede the mobility of AU tanks. The AU and the government-backed forces are expected to launch a joint military operation against the Islamic opposition. The tunnels may impede the mobility of the AU forces in these areas. However, observers are saying that these tunnels will not be able to stop the types of tanks and armored vehicles being used by the AU forces.
بكل General Stanley McChrystal, the top commander of U.S. and NATO forces in Afghanistan, warned in a report that he submitted to the U.S. Secretary of Defense that the military operation there may fail without sending additional soldiers to the war against the Taliban.
According to the report, parts of which were made public, McChrystal requested that a significant amount of additional U.S. troops be sent to Afghanistan. He warned that the war in Afghanistan will last longer without more U.S. troops, and the deployed forces there will suffer more losses.
زيادة القوات الأمريكية في أفغانستان أمر مصيري بالنسبة للحرب التي تخوضها الولايات المتحدة وحلفاؤها هناك.
Increasing U.S. troops in Afghanistan is an inevitable matter in the war that the United States and its allies have become involved in. This is what the commander of these forces, General Stanley McChrystal, said in a report that he submitted to the U.S. Secretary of Defense, Robert Gates. In his report, McChrystal painted a dim picture of the war in Afghanistan, stating clearly that the situation there was chaotic and on the verge of collapse. One of the points that he stresses is that the NATO forces in Afghanistan assume they are protecting the Afghan people, but they are operating in a way that actually alienates and distances them. According to the 66-page report, the Taliban cannot defeat the NATO forces, but the NATO forces may exhaust themselves if the current situation continues.
ويدعو ماكريستل في تقريره لأن يكون الهدف الأول للقوات الأطلسية.
McChrystal states in the report that the NATO forces' first goal should be protecting the Afghan civilians instead of killing the Taliban fighters. He pointed out that Taliban members have full control over some regions in Afghanistan and that their intelligence abilities have improved tremendously. On the other hand, McChrystal indicates in the report that the weakness of government institutions, the corruption of President Hamid Karzai's government cabinet, and the mismanagement of authority are all factors that make Afghan people turn their backs on their government. McChrystal requested that 10 to 40,000 additional soldiers be sent to Afghanistan. This report was released a day after U.S. President Barack Obama stated in a speech that he would wait on the matter of sending additional soldiers to Afghanistan, emphasizing the importance of adopting the right strategy first. This wait angered Republican leaders in Congress. Senator John McCain warned that any delay in sending additional troops to Afghanistan is threatening the lives of American soldiers there. Meanwhile, not many Democrats share McCain's position. A bigger problem for Obama is that the latest public opinion poll in the U.S. shows that a majority of Americans oppose continuing the war in Afghanistan.
Joining us from Washington is the bureau chief of Al Jazeera, Abdul Rahim Fukara. Abdul Rahim, what are your observations of this American political development?
Naturally, American government institutions expected that McChrystal's report would request an increase in U.S. soldiers in Afghanistan. The Secretary of Defense, Robert Gates, felt that increasing the number of soldiers may make the Afghan people feel that they are under occupation, according to what he said. The problem is not only in the hands of the Secretary of Defense, but also in Barack Obama's hands. Obama made the war in Afghanistan a cornerstone of his policies. And all the relevant political parties with a stake in Afghanistan were pushing for an increase in the number of the troops. McChrystal will go to Congress, and it's unlikely that Congress will reject his request.
Thank you very much, Abdul Rahim Fukara, from Washington.
Italy held an official and public funeral procession for the six soldiers who were killed in the bombing that the Taliban carried out in the Afghan capital of Kabul last week. Italian President Giorgio Napolitano, Prime Minister Silvio Berlusconi, and other high-ranking officials attended the funeral, which was held in the Church of St. Paul in Rome. Italian soldiers carried the coffins of the six soldiers in an atmosphere of sadness, with the Italian public watching on the sidelines. Flags were lowered on the government buildings, and many stores were closed for the occasion. The bodies of the six soldiers arrived in Rome on Sunday, accompanied by four soldiers who were injured in the same incident.
الوجه الإنساني للصراع الدائر في شمال اليمن بين القوات الحكومية والحوثيين يعود إلى الواجهة مجددا.
The level of humanitarian concern has increased in northern Yemen as clashes continue to erupt between Yemeni government forces and Houthi rebels. The humanitarian situation in the Yemeni province of Sa'ada is continuing to deteriorate and is causing deep concern. According to Melissa Fleming, spokeswoman for the UN High Commission for Refugees, or UNHCR, the town of Sa'ada has been cut off since the war started nearly 5 weeks ago, which is hampering relief efforts in the province.
فترات الهدوء المتقطعة. أشارت فليمينغ إلى أن النداءات المتكررة التي أطلقها.
Fleming further said that the UNHCR was able to provide aid to some of the refugees during sporadic periods of calm. However, repeated pleas issued by the UNHCR to raise $5 million to cover the cost of humanitarian efforts have not been met. On the battlefield, the fighting between the Yemeni army and Houthi fighters continues to escalate in Sa'ada. The Yemeni army said that they have foiled an attempt by the rebels to infiltrate and seize the Republican Palace in Sa'ada. According to army sources, 140 Houthi rebels have been killed in the attack on Sa'ada.
من المتمردين الحوثيين. من صنعاء ينضم إلينا علي الجرادي رئيس تحرير.
Joining us from Sana'a is Ali Al-Jaradi, editor-in-chief of the Yemeni newspaper Al-Ahali. Ali, the fighting in Yemen continues to escalate. Houthi rebels attempted to seize control of government headquarters in Sa'ada yesterday. Where do you think the situation is headed?
The situation is escalating. The ceasefire agreement announced by both sides didn't last. There appears to be some kind of question in the region about responsibility, and this is hampering efforts to reach an agreement, especially from a Houthi standpoint. Once again, the ceasefire agreement didn't last. Both sides started to blame and accuse each other just an hour after the agreement was announced. The Houthis had previously announced a unilateral ceasefire. Yesterday, the Yemeni government announced a ceasefire in observance of the Eid al-Fitr holiday and in response to calls from the United Nations and international humanitarian organizations. However, the ceasefire didn't last. The Houthi rebels attempted to seize control of Sa'ada on the eve of the Eid al-Fitr holiday. However, the Houthis suffered major military losses in Sa'ada. Today, there was a relative calm on the front lines, which perhaps signaled an attempt to prepare for more fierce battles in the days ahead.
تفيد الأنباء الواردة من اليمن بأن اشتباكات متقطعة تدور بين القوات الحكومية.
Incoming reports from Yemen said that intermittent clashes broke out between the government forces and Houthi rebels in the area of Sa'ada in northern Yemen. Local sources quoted the official Yemeni news agency, saying that the death toll among Houthi rebels in the violent clashes yesterday has risen to 150.
فجراً بدأ هجوم الحوثيين حسب ما صرحت مصادر الجيش.
According to military sources, the Houthis began their attack at dawn. They targeted the presidential palace in Sa'ada city in the northern part of Yemen. The attack was carried out from different directions and made its way into the city. The fighting continued until noon and ended with Houthis retreating from the battleground. Dozens of them were killed. The Yemeni military said that 5 of its soldiers were killed in combat and 25 others were injured. It also said that over 60 Houthi members surrendered to the government forces. A report from Sana'a said that the intermittent clashes started soon after the battle between the Houthis and the government forces ended.
أما الحوثيون فينفون ما تقوله مصادر.
The Houthis denied what the military said and accused it of violating the ceasefire agreement that the government announced on the occasion of the Eid al-Fitr holiday. The Houthis say that the government ordered its forces to shell civilians in the nearby villages. They tried to remind people of the previous attacks that the Yemeni military launched and uploaded photos of the victims of those attacks on the internet to prove that the government was targeting civilians.
استهداف الحكومة للمدنيين. وبين اتهام واتهام مضاد يراوح وقف اطلاق النار الذي.
Amidst the exchange of accusations, the fragile ceasefire agreement which was announced by the government is about to fail. This means that the civilians living in the combat zones are bound to begin their Eid al-Fitr holiday with bombing and shelling. Both sides seem to be fueling political tensions. There is no common ground for reaching a political solution to the crisis. Assad Bahisawi, BBC.
Mr. Benjamin Netanyahu is en route to New York, where he will address the United Nations General Assembly and will take part in a trilateral summit with U.S. President Barack Obama and PA President Mahmoud Abbas. Hebei's diplomatic correspondent Leah Zinder brings us up to date from our Tel Aviv studio. Leah.
Yes, hi, Laura. Hi, Yochanan. Prime Minister Netanyahu, as you said, accompanied by his wife, Sarah, and his advisors, left Ben-Gurion Airport a short time ago after bringing off an impressive feat, at least in the short term. Netanyahu stood firm against the intense pressure of U.S. presidential envoy George Mitchell, the pressure that continued all of last week, virtually until the start of the Rosh Hashanah holiday. And the prime minister refused the U.S. demand for a total settlement freeze, though he did agree to a 9-month moratorium on building in the settlements. And despite Netanyahu's unbending position and the threats and ultimatums of the Palestinian leadership, when President Obama called Abbas on Friday to invite him to the three-way meeting, Abbas had virtually no choice but to agree, even though he insists it will be no more than a photo opportunity, not the resumption of negotiations. That summit will take place tomorrow morning at the Waldorf Astoria in New York, after both Netanyahu and Abbas meet separately with the U.S. president. On the face of it, then, Israel scored two important points. First, as I said, it forced Washington to step back from what many believe was its disastrous insistence on an absolute building freeze. But also, Netanyahu rejected the preconditions posed by the Palestinians before resuming peace talks, the first time the Palestinians had imposed such conditions. However, of course, it remains to be seen how the U.S. will respond, and the world's only superpower has its ways of showing its displeasure. But let's hear now from a Palestinian official on the upcoming summit.
This is not acceptance from the Palestinian side to resume negotiations with Israel prior to the cessation of settlement activities, including the natural growth. This might not be a popular meeting from the Palestinian perspective, but this is something that comes as a step, positive step from the Palestinian side towards Mr. Obama rather than towards Mr. Netanyahu.
Shop owners in the area of New Baghdad complained about the security barriers around their markets because it hinders the movement of vehicles, especially during holidays and special occasions.
Shop owners demanded that the government make it easier for vehicles carrying products to enter the market.
During the last 10 days of Ramadan, especially as the holiday of Eid al-Fitr approaches, Iraqi citizens are going to the markets in greater numbers. However, security forces decided to close some of the roads leading to big markets. This is the case of the New Baghdad market.
These barriers make it hard for us to do business. We have to drive the trucks inside so that we can transport the products. We sell different kinds of meat, and meat can spoil quickly. We want them to work with us, but they tell us that our market is big and that they must make sure it is secured. Of course, they are right.
They have to make sure that no explosions take place here. This is an important market.
We demand that the current government remove these barriers. They keep this area closed around the clock.
Iraqis developed new ways to maintain security based on past experiences. Some suggested using a system of badges so that the cars carrying products can be allowed to enter quickly.
We want regular traffic to return to the market. They should use a system of badges so everyone can come in and leave easily.
We want them to bring new equipment so they can search citizens in cars. This would enable them to search people as they come and go.
Political analysts differ in their opinions on security barriers. Some focus on the negative aspects, while others focus on the benefits.
Taking security measures without studying their impact leads to negative results. The possible economic, social, and economic consequences of some security measures must be studied beforehand.
Security barriers are important for the security of shoppers. Security forces must keep explosives and booby-trapped vehicles from getting into the markets in order to protect citizens.
Al Iraqiya contacted Iraqi security officials in charge of the area, who told us that they are trying to get rid of these security barriers so that they will be gone after the blessed holiday of Eid al-Fitr. Shop owners and citizens hope that the security situation will improve so that these barriers can be removed. Until then, security officials can only make promises to citizens who can only express their wishes.
مساعد وزير الخارجية المصري للشؤون العربية عبد الرحمن صلاح الدين كشف.
Egyptian Assistant Foreign Minister for Arabic Affairs Abdul Rahman Salah al-Din revealed that a meeting between the interior ministers of Iraq's neighboring countries is scheduled to take place on October 4th in the Shamal Sheikh Resort in Egypt. Bahrain, Egypt, and the League of Arab States will attend the meeting. Salah al-Din said that the goal of this meeting is to discuss the contribution of neighboring countries to the protection and support of Iraq's security. The meeting will also cover the measures that each neighboring country has taken to improve security in Iraq, as well as the necessary plans for cooperation between neighboring countries. The official spokesman for the General Command Center of the Security Forces for the Kurdistan region, Major General Jabbar Yawar, announced that joint forces will be deployed soon to conflict areas between Baghdad and the region. Iraqi and Kurdish Peshmerga forces and U.S. troops have been deployed to the town of Sanjar in Mosul province. Hams Uthman has details from Erbil.
Iraqi Peshmerga and U.S. joint forces were deployed on the ground several days ago in the town of Sanjar in Nineveh province. This area witnessed a number of explosions carried out by terrorists a few days ago. The deployment of these forces was proposed several weeks ago by the top U.S. military commander in Iraq, General Ray Odierno. The official spokesman for the General Command Center of the Security Forces of the Kurdistan region in Iraq, Major General Jabbar Yawar, said in an exclusive interview with Al-Samaria TV that the deployment of the joint forces will soon begin in the areas that cause disputes between Baghdad and the region.
The bombings aren't a main reason for deploying these forces. Initially, there was a meeting about forming a joint task force between the regional government of Kurdistan, the Iraqi government, and in multinational forces, then deploying them to all the areas of conflict. These areas include Nineveh province, Kirkuk province, and Diyala province. This plan was implemented starting in Mosul province because Mosul is a special case. So far, there are great threats that terrorists may strike in these areas. The first step in deploying these forces started in the town of Sinjar.
In response to the opposition's stance on the deployment of these forces, Yawar reiterated that we respect all opinions opposing the deployment of the joint forces, but we are surprised by those who are opposed to our participation as Iraqis.
We respect these opinions from some of the political figures, but we are also surprised by them. Why? Because, first of all, like I said, these forces have a military mission for security, and they will not interfere in political affairs. Second, the Peshmerga and other security forces in the Kurdish region of Iraq are constitutional forces, according to the Fifth Amendment of Article 121 of the Iraqi Constitution.
Yawar added that the senior officials of the Iraqi, U.S., and Peshmerga joint troops had a series of meetings recently and reached a consensus about forming and deploying the joint forces to the disputed areas. Hams Uthman, Al-Samaria TV, Erbil.
Finally, Muslims in the Chinese capital of Beijing have celebrated Eid al-Fitr festivities, marking the end of the holy fasting month of Ramadan. They gathered at mosques all across the city early in the morning on Monday. We have Kathleen Chang with the details of this story.
Thousands of Muslims in China's capital, Beijing, flocked to mosques on Monday to celebrate their main festival, Eid Fitr. Prayers and preaching by imams started in the early morning. Eid Fitr holiday is one of the main festivals of Muslims that signals the end of the Muslim holy month of Ramadan, a season of fasting and spiritual reflection.
The Eid holiday is one of the three main holidays for Muslims. This is the happiest day for us after a whole month of observing Ramadan.
During Ramadan, the ninth month of the year in the lunar calendar, Muslims refrain from eating, drinking, and smoking from sunrise to sunset. But children, elderly people, and the weak do not have to observe the fast. Ma Zhongjie, vice president of the China Islamic Association, says the government has been supportive of the holiday.
All the government officials and Han people congratulated us and showed their respects to us. There are more than 80 mosques in Beijing, and lots of people have come out to pray.
A local Muslim said the ethnic riot that occurred in western China's Xinjiang province did not affect the life of Muslims in Beijing.
Our life is as normal as before, and we don't get discriminated because of the Xinjiang ethnic riots.
Violent street battles killed nearly 200 people in the deadliest ethnic unrest that hit China's volatile western Xinjiang region in July. Uyghur activist Rabia Kadir, who was accused of instigating the riot, says Chinese policies are diluting their culture and marginalizing them economically. Ma, on the other hand, doesn't agree.
We have the policy of freedom of religious belief. The government supports our activities and there aren't any challenges for Chinese Muslims. One challenge maybe is that some Muslims are poor and can't get enough food. That's one challenge.
China now has 21 million Muslims, half being of the Hui minority group.
The month-long Islamic holiday has come and gone without any hitches, despite the ongoing concern in Xinjiang and the government security measures in preparation for the 60th anniversary of the People's Republic of China. The Muslims we've talked to feel optimistic about the future. Kathleen Chang, Press TV, Beijing.
Get more news about the Middle East online at linktv.org/mosaic. The Mosaic webpage offers a complete archive of Mosaic programs, program transcripts, the Mosaic video podcast, and the Mosaic Intelligence Report, a weekly analysis of the hottest stories from the Middle East. The views expressed on Mosaic are those of the participating broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible with the support of viewers like you. Thank you.
This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. network dedicated to global and national news, uncompromising documentaries, and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.